But to get us started for this afternoon's first panel then, happy to introduce Bruno Carvalho, Associate Professor of Spanish and Portuguese Languages and Cultures, also very involved with the Princeton Mellon Initiative on Architecture, Humanities, and Urbanism. I think I got a few of those in the wrong order, but here at Princeton. So thank you, Bruno, for taking part in this.
So I'll start. Start joining the chorus of thanking Daniel for making this happen. So I'll be very, very brief so we can get right to our two wonderful speakers, the first of which is no less than Emily Apter, professor of French and Comparative Literature at NYU, and also chair of Comparative Literature at the moment, and author of books a lot of us are very fond of, especially on the literature side, Continental Drift, From Natural Characters to Virtual Subjects, The Translation Zone, A New Comparative Literature, and more recently, Against World Literature, on the politics of untranslatability. So without further ado, please.
So my remarks today, and thank you to everyone for organizing. My remarks today intervene in an emerging debate around the critical digital in the humanities. So I'm a little bit shifting the discussion, I think, from this morning. Encompassing a disparate set of concerns, if not a field, ranging, at least within my own specializations, from the use of data mining in translation theory and practice to referentially indeterminate notions of what constitutes a data environment or field of geomedia. My focus today will be on the material and metaphoric status of the mining metaphor in the language of data mining, itself built on commonplace expressions that connect mining and knowledge acquisition. You know them well, digging for information, extracting knowledge, excavating the text, and so on. The assumptions embedded in these expressions continue to resonate, and especially in digital research projects, to wit, Stanford's projects on the digging into the Enlightenment, mapping the Republic of Letters. So the mining knowledge episteme and its material associations gained traction during the early modern period. From Leibniz in the Hartz silver mines to the chemists in the Swedish Bureau of Mines, mining was synonymous with the extraction of knowledge from nature, gradually replacing Paracelsian Neoplatonic mysticism with experiment. I'm sorry, I just touched the screen. It's a little, and it's reacting with experiment. I show you here the frontispiece of Jeremias Drexel's Orifodina, literally gold mine, and sometimes given the full title, The Mine of All Arts and Sciences, which was a 17th century treatise on the art of note-taking, the ars excerpendi, the art of taking notes. And you see at the bottom, there's a motto here, from iron to the pen, hic ferro, and it goes through to the other side, hic columo, to the pen. And it seems to be, I'm not too good at reading iconography, others were more expert, but to go up through the humanities up on the top there. Slide 2 is from a plate in the Encyclopédie, the mining entry. And while the image itself doesn't draw an explicit connection between mining and knowledge, it calls forth comparison with another encyclopedie plate that adapts the old tree of knowledge figure for an Enlightenment map of the system of human knowledge. So taken together, these images model Turanian and cognitive substructure, a kind of brain with sub rosa roots, stem, and branches. We think of cerebral cortex, medulla, thalamus. And a system, more abstractly, of analogical relays among mining and memory, conscious surface and unconscious depth, brain chemistry, and physical nature. And part of what is really tricky here, especially I noticed there was in the earlier discussion a use of the term translation. Are we using that as just a general term? How material is it at any given point? And that's part of what I'm looking into here. The slippages between conceptual and material usage in the language of mining articulate links between data mining and the extractive industries, apparent in slogans like data is the new oil. In what follows, I'll look briefly at how glossaries of data mining are implicated in practices of fracking, clear-cutting, and mountaintopping. And I'll also develop the concept of overburden in its possible application to knowledge fields. Additional questions will include, to what extent have data or mining, or the two words hyphenated, translated a reigning paradigm of computational research that occupies a position similar to that of language at the height of the linguistic turn? Is data mining, in other words, a language that the digital humanities speaks? And if so, what is its relation to code or code language? How is it inscribing also, and this interests me as someone working on the politics of translation, a monolingual drive in contemporary research functionalism? And finally, how might we read the mining in data mining as a form of translational materialism? Now let me be a literary person for a moment. Let me begin with a translation problem. Frederick Jameson's classic work of 1972, The Prison House of Language, A Critical Account of Structuralism and Russian Formalism, opens with an epigraph taken from Nietzsche's late notebooks and often included in editions of The Will to Power. Quote, this is how it appears in Jameson. We have to cease to think if we refuse to do it in the prison house of language, for we cannot reach further than the doubt, which asks whether the limit we see is really a limit. In the original German, as you see there, wir hören auf zu denken, wenn wir es nicht in dem sprachlichen Zwange zu tun wollen, wir langen gerade noch dem Zweifel an, hier eine Grenze als Grenze zu sehen. This was translated by Walter Kaufmann. We cease to think when we refuse to do so under the constraint of language. We barely reach the doubt that sees this limitation as a limitation. The translation included in Rüdiger Bittner's 2003 edition of Nietzsche's Late Aphorisms followed suit in adopting constraints of language for sprachlichen Zwange. So where did the prison house come from? Certainly it seemed to be compatible with the German term for limit, which comes later, die Grenze, which can also reference the border police, border patrol or police checkpoint. It appears that Jameson took prison house from Erich Heller's free translation in an essay published in 1963 on Wittgenstein and Nietzsche. David Lufkin alleges that, quote, Jameson has apparently copied Heller's translation without indicating the metaphor's origins, perhaps without knowing them. And literary critics have slavishly referred to the importance of this notion, the prison house of language, with no sense of context or limitation. Jameson adds force to the notion of the academic assembly line, by example, in its reduction of language to arbitrary non-referential expression. I'm sorry, I had that quote. Yeah, no, here it's right. Ernst Behler, editor of Nietzsche's Complete Works in English, weighs in with a harsh verdict of mistranslation. He says, the difference between prison house of language and constraint of language may appear small, but is really not when Nietzsche's read as a language theorist. Then the notion of a prison house of language conveys a sinister finality, which Nietzsche's text actually does not express. For we are always capable of outdoing and outwitting the constraint of language through style, metaphorical language, irony, and other rhetorical means. And I won't finish it all, but you can read it. Anyway, what comes to the fore in both critiques is the conviction that Jameson misread the notion of limit in language, overreading its carceral restriction, underestimating its fungibility as a porous boundary, as, to borrow from Thomas Tresize on this Nietzsche phrase, an interiority, quote, engendered by the necessity of its own transgression, much as the restricted economy is produced by the force of a general economy that exceeds it. And thus, falling into the trap of a linguistic determinism often ascribed to Wittgenstein's pensum, the familiar one, about what one cannot speak, one must remain silent, most often taken to mean that language is an absolute limit to thought. Jameson's title was and continues to be read as shorthand for a structuralist vision of linguistic totality, one that, and this is actually relevant to what I'll be saying later, one that leaves the subject walled in, unable to escape discursive laws and hierarchies, or the a priori condition of grammatical deep structure. Certainly, Jameson foregrounded Ferdinand de Saussure's linguistic model, crediting him for his insistence on, quote, the fact that language as a total system is complete at every moment, no matter what happens to have been altered in it a moment before. The Saussurean model is temporally, synchronically qualified by Jameson as, quote, a series of complete systems succeeding each other in time. Language, for him, is a perpetual present, he's saying of Saussure, with all the possibilities of meaning implicit in its every moment, end of quote. And yet, the Nietzsche quote in the original German implies more doubt about the conditions of internment in language. Rather than being darkly entrapped in a structure of the permanent present, Nietzsche would seem to tarry with the boxes all-encompassing, limitless architecture. If we want to think, we must resolve to think within the limit otherwise. In the place of a totalizing allness, there would be refracted lines of flight that lead perception or intuition, perhaps via other languages or translation or affect, to other modes of expressionism, to intimations of the unthought. The interpretation of Zwang as self-transgressive constraint turns the prison house of language into something more like a prism house of language. Reading Nietzsche, Heller, Jameson prismatically, the metaphor of carceral entrapment yields to a crystalline structure refracting a celestial sphere of noetics beyond language. We arrive at this prismatics by means of a performative actio within translatio, the process whereby a delimited term or concept limit is subject to sublation, worked over by the Aufhebung of translation. In this case, the term confronts the wall of nonsense inside a discrete tongue, but defies its own monolingual boundary, moving across die Grenze, the checkpoint, into plurilingual language worlds, where the what of reference or predicate of what a word means is traduced, some would say deconstructed, through translation. Prismatic translation in this sense implies a political unbordering, a linguistic subsumption of Zwang, such that monolingual totality is suspended by the performative force of perpetual translating. This translation machination is theoretically realizable as a digital humanities project, one that might take its cue from a conference brief on prismatic translation, an event that I attended at St. Anne's College, Oxford in October 2015. And here's their conference brief. It's rather interesting. They say, might there be any virtue in translation practices that routinely display variance instead of routinely choosing among them? Are there practices more at home in new digital media than in the old technology of the book? And here's more interesting. Is it problematic that global translation is dominated by a few major languages? Can machines contribute to a prismatic translation culture, or will they blight it? Could translation prisms be a resource for cross-linguistic, cross-scriptal, cross-cultural study at the micro level? Surely machines do contribute to a prismatic translation culture, especially insofar as they advance micrological, cross-scriptal, cross-cultural study. Prismatic translation, powered up with the resources of data mining and sophisticated software, would take to the next power an older model of polysystems translation developed in the 90s, which gave rise to translation practices that challenged the, quote, original text as an absolute point of reference, the representational theory of language designed to account for translating meaning successfully from one language to another, and the postulate of reliable categories for detecting equivalences between the source and target document, end of quote. That's from Müller, Vollmer, and Michael Imscher. Prismatizing the original, the theorists of the 90s relativized its presumptive authority, shifting the axis to polysemic target languages. And we can see this approach at work in Baylor's critical edition of Nietzsche, which instead of hewing to the official German edition, foregrounds the fluctuation and disunity of Nietzsche's thought, destabilizing any notion of an original by setting Nietzsche's work inside a network of notes, fragments, and unpublished versions of manuscripts. Baylor models a practice of translatio that emphasizes Nietzsche's multiplicity of perspectives and constant shifting from position to counterposition. Contemporary translation in an era of digital humanities suggests all over maximal worlds of translation. Graphic adventures in transmedial or hypertextual translation, unfinished philological symphonies, or spin-offs of what the French call génétique, where instead of arriving at the final version, the published or officially disseminated text becomes a panoply of variations that reaches no terminus, approximating instead the continuously self-differentiating process work tasked with non-totalizable project. Prismatic translation in these terms reconciles translatio to big data, to data mining programs built up from lexical search engines that allow for comparisons among past translations, mistranslations, and hypothetical translations. It implies a kind of possible world's theory of translation that by technically showing the math of translational decisionism allows us to see something virtual, thinking in translation, the process philosophy of the verb to translate. One could object that this prismatics retains something prison-like because it submits data users to the infrastructural colossus of exponentiated research software and the epistemological absolutism of logiciel, but that would be of a different and much the subject of a different and much longer meditation. In Prison House of Language, Jameson does not deal directly with the impact of research technology on the humanities, but with Thomas Kuhn's structure of scientific revolutions clearly in mind, he presciently heralds the computer as the next great paradigm shifter. He opens Prison House with an apodictic pronouncement, quote, "The history of thought is the history of its models. Classical mechanics, the organism, natural selection, the atomic nucleus of, or electronic field, the computer. Such are some of the objects or systems which, first used to organize our understanding of the natural world, have been called upon to illuminate human reality," end of quote. For Jameson, the model lives within a certain life cycle. In its early years, it achieves stability, serving as a medium through which a new view of the universe may be obtained and cataloged. Later, however, the model starts to decline, and a proportionately greater amount of time has to be spent in readjusting the model itself, in bringing it back into line with its object of study. Now, research tends to become theoretical rather than practical, and to turn back upon its own presuppositions, the structure of the model itself, finding itself vexed by the false problems and dilemmas into which the inadequacy of the model seems increasingly to lead it. One thinks, for example, of the ether or of collective consciousness. The big stress test here of the structural linguistic model becomes inevitable after it sweeps through the other disciplines and usurps the place of philology and stylistics in literary theory. And here's a final quote, "Nothing could be more fitting, one would think, than the application of linguistic methods to literature, itself essentially a linguistic structure. Yet the older stylistics, that of Spitzer and Auerbach or J.P. Richard, Jean-Pierre Richard, worked much more closely with the verbal texture of the work itself. We find ourselves ultimately before the conclusion that the attempt to see the literary work as a linguistic system is in reality the application of a metaphor. Okay, so here is where I want to dwell for a minute. Of particular interest here, and what I find especially relevant to the problems and challenges posed by digital humanities work, is precisely the metaphoric status of its paradigms, its meta-language. And as I've already asked, in a sense, to what extent are these two words, data mining, hyphenated, occupying the same position that language did at that height of the linguistic turn? Is data mining, what is its relation to algorithmic code? Is it continuous with it, parasitic on it, mimetic of it? How does code inscribe a numerological unconscious or monolingual drive within the language of research? An attempt to answer these questions will, on my part, won't entail evaluating technologies of machine translation. That's really not my area of competence. Nor will I pretend to take stock of how machine translation is changing in interesting ways the political landscape of translation, either with respect to written documents, especially in the fields of international law and human rights, or oral communication in real time, in real life situations, from war zones to tourism to web-based finance capitalism. Instead, following Jameson's analysis of the linguistic model in the era of structuralism, I would focus on data mining as the premier model of the moment, for better or for worse, approaching it first as a technology that enables plurilingual research, second, as a praxis that reinforces the drive to monolingualism in the humanities, with particular consequences for comparative literature, which is the field and the teaching of languages and literatures. And third is a kind of invisible translation, and this is probably the most interesting in a way, a kind of invisible translation, a translation on the surface of language, hiding as it were in plain sight, yet curiously unremarked as translation. I'm thinking here specifically about the way data mining translates or remediates the language of materialist ecology and business-based best practices without ever being recognized as translation. Mario Carpa makes a relevant observation about the expression big data. Quote, big data is a cultural trope more than a technical term. Yet the expression of originally referred simply to our technical capacity to collect, store, and process increasing amounts of data at decreasing costs. And this original meaning still stands, regardless of hype, media improprieties, or semasiological confusion. That's a term referring to cognitive semantics. Carpa presses on the ambiguous relation of a cultural trope to a technical term, and I want to follow suit. Pressing on the ambiguous relation of a trope of materialism, industrial ecology, to lexical research and translation theory. Translational data, treated as non-delimited corpora, organized around keywords and textual variants, lends itself to data analytics and experiments with the graphics of hermeneutic modeling, and it has for a while now. Here's what a model of meta-language looked like in 1972 in Jameson's Prison House of Language. And here's what its data mine counterpart looks like today. I'm showing you two images from Franco Moretti's pamphlet number 6 of the Stanford Literary Lab, titled Quantitative Formalism and Experiment, that uses the program DocuScope to test whether, quote, computer-generated algorithms could recognize literary genres, end of quote. In his own contribution to the pamphlet, Moretti replaces the hermeneutics of reading with what he calls the operationalization of literary information, naming it the hero of a grandiose research enterprise, quote, a bridge from concepts to measurement and then to the world. So characters in the system turn into calculable units that form data sets that may be instrumentalized in literary research, transforming for Moretti the substance and stakes of literary theory. In the process, there is a surreptitious transfer of properties whereby a general metaphor of computational instrumental reason is, as it were, transubstantiated, thereby turning literary character into pure instrument, an incarnation of utensility. A long quote, I apologize, but it's kind of interesting. I'll just pick out a few bits of it. So he talks about the protagonist as a utensil, character space as an instrument. The protagonist is a utensil because it belongs to the world of readerly common sense and doesn't go beyond it. Character space is an instrument because it's the realization of a theory that wants to understand something that, quote, does not fall under the domain of our senses. And I will skip a little bit here, go to the end, where he talks about, as the logic of research has brought us face to face with conceptual issues, they should openly become the task of the day, the task of the day, countering the pervasive cliches on the simple-minded positivism of digital humanities. Computation has theoretical consequences, possibly more than any other field of literary study. The time has come to make them explicit. So Moretti's application of data mining to narrative units within literary history has tended to produce interesting atlases of genre and canon evolution, but in my view, delivers far less satisfactorily on textual analysis. Closer to my preferred model of critical digital is Peter DeBola's The Architecture of Concepts, The Historical Formation of Human Rights, a book which activates cross-channel mistranslations of right and droit in its exposition of political theory and brings out difference or differentials, areas of the untranslatable, in constructs like rights of man and human rights. The book experiments with combining philology and digital methodology. As Christopher Prendergast notes, it offers positive gains to scalar knowledge, which are kind of incontestable. He says, scanning short to very long sequences of texts embedded in a huge corpus of digitized textual material. This is a form of inquiry which moves on from the history of concepts as a history of meanings based on dictionary definitions to the fleshing out of environments in which the formation, structure, and function of concepts are mapped in terms of neighborhood relations on a hitherto unimaginable scale. Now, my response to this is that before waxing too euphoric about what data-mined research across languages can do, let me note that this plurilingual method is fundamentally contravened by the lingua franca of data mining itself, or can be, certainly. Called out by Barbara Cassin as globish, a standardized, reduced form of English that undermines the entropic freedom of her project, which is to philosophize in languages. And it also revalidates linguistic universalism and univocity by virtue of its default algorithmic code. Globish and code fall under what Joanna Drucker, in her influential essay, Humanistic Theory and Digital Scholarship, dubs technological restraints. She writes, humanities content meant digital methods and created projects in which the terms of production were necessarily set by technological restraints. Okay, not a long quote. These restraints or constraints, to reprise the Nietzschean term of Zwang discussed earlier, apply not just to research objects bounded by techniques, but also to epistemes ruled by outcome-driven analytics. This is the schemata for data mining languages. This is the lexicon. And you can see how when it merges with information pre-processing right here, this is simplified to HTML, tokenization, and stemming. and higher level knowledge moves towards a database that dumps into bins that resemble trash bins. In deferring to streamlined forms of English, from business or basic English to internet inflected forms of Globish, data mining promulgates a presumptive stance against translation. Plurilingualism is de facto off the table because its utility is minimal or task-specific in limited ways. The logic of cultural understanding, often invoked to support translational pedagogies, can easily be dismissed as fuzzy or uncongenial to transcoding or other communication technologies. A second related problem, with the adoption of digital methods of research, one sees the mission creep of management patois and the heuristics of a value-added humanities education, with consequences for what kinds of research get funded or receive broad institutional support. Any of us working in the humanities is very aware of this. Check any glossary of data mining or digital research, corporate website, and one immediately discerns that the basic terms are impossible to disintricate from normative standards of optimization and customer service. You'll note here binning, the process of breaking up continuous values into bins that performs a service to processing, or brute force algorithm, a computationally cheap, though inefficient way of achieving value-added results. It's difficult to determine how much of this language is referentially material, of course, and how much is metaphor for an economy of optimal production and managed waste. All of it, I would say, contributes to the commercialization of knowledge projects, to the drift towards the formal requisites and use values of product. And this leads to the third problem, as I see it, which stems from the complex and as yet relatively underexamined relationship between the language of mining and the extractive industries, particularly oil, gas, and minerals. Mining, as we've seen, is a very old epistemic figure associated with exploratory research and modes of symptomatic reading. And as we recall again, these expressions, digging beneath the surface, dredging up what's hidden below, extracting what is important, and so on. But when coupled with the word data, mining resonates strongly with the language of the extraction industries, as in the term data refinery. This is an image of an abstract diagram of what data looks like when it is, quote, refined. And you'll see, and I know this is a little bit glib here, but it has a vague formal resemblance to what a petroleum refinery looks like. Implicit here is a certain commensurability between knowledge computation and environmentally destructive practices, specifically the discarding of waste or unvalued material. The industry term for this is overburden and may be associated with the fallout of clear-cutting, mountain-topping, fracking, and river dredging. The lexicon includes terms that may be read as translations within a referential framework that slides from material reference, indexing damaging toxic environmental practices, to pure metaphors of formal systems of data management. Salient examples include data dredging, which refers to data sets deemed too small to draw valid statistical inferences from, data fracking, which refers to the use of hidden measures to extract data, drilling down, associated with foraging deep within information systems in order to make determinations of sales impacts or customer satisfaction and corporate profit, and data exhaust, that's my favorite one, designating information byproduct, such as storable choices, actions, and preferences that can be repackaged and resold, and the glosseme CART, C-A-R-T, which stands for classification and regression trees, and is defined as, quote, a type of decision tree algorithm that automates the pruning process through cross-validation and other techniques. So CART illustrates the normative wobble between very anodyne senses of pruning, a favored speech for textual editing, and clear-cutting, a method of logging that strips out topsoil, contributing to deforestation and climate change. These slippages take us back to the eco-political meta-language found in Jameson's Prison House of Language, where he describes the structuralist project of decoding and decipherment as geological upheaval. And he borrows this metaphor from Claude Lévi-Strauss, who in Tristes Tropiques interpreted the arid soil and millenary stagnation in his native Languedoc region as both brute material sign and a kind of master meaning, maître sens, of structuralist decoding. Interpreted as surface translation, a translation of what is lying on the surface but which is neither being perceived nor understood, the lexicon of data mining discloses potential damage wreaked by the unsafe disposal of overburden. We might think of whole areas of vital research and critical inquiry, languages, the humanities, as such, becoming classifiable as overburden. This is, of course, an overreading of overburden. But what I want to underscore in concluding is that the digital languages that IRT speak are based on the abstraction of extraction, itself grounded in a language of branding and digital communications, a patois of managementese, to borrow Keller Easterling's felicitous description. Data mining, considered as a language that commingles ecologies of resource harvesting and the abstract computational modeling of data environments, takes us beyond the limit, the zwang, of a critique of corporate monolingualism, which is kind of where I started, and into the problem of translating the materialism of digital linguistic ecologies. Thank you.
Now we will hear from Orit Halpern, who's an associate professor of interactive design in the Department of Sociology and Anthropology at Concordia University, whose last book has the wonderfully suggestive title of Beautiful Data, A History of Vision and Reason Since 1945.
Thank you, Daniel, for the invitation. It's really exciting to be here. I want to say, I want to change my whole talk right now after the things I've heard last night and this morning. I think there'll be a big conversation, and also hopefully a little bit with Emily's work on questions of both translation and also the forms of metaphors about how we think about futurity under particular media conditions. I want to say this is a highly speculative talk. It's really different from most of my work, which is actually on histories of interactivity, attention, big data, cognitive, neuroscience, cybernetics, along with design and architecture. But it's also part of this new problem that I'm dealing with about what sort of practices or pedagogies, coming back to Reinhold's question, are we going to develop in order to get designers and architects working together with humanities people in terms of thinking about futurity. So this is all really speculative, and I really don't know much about the Anthropocene, but I'm going to try. So anyway. Lately, one of the things I've noticed that infrastructures are, many tell us, difficult to see. They hide in plain sight. Their ubiquity, their sort of obscuration, their usefulness, their cloak. Unless broken, they remain in the background or even underground. Their obscurity also hides the many debates settled, won, or dismissed along their way to widespread adoption. Scholars, activists, journalists, or artists thus often claim to reveal the values at work in these systems by bringing the systems themselves into light. And I'm just going to show a couple really popular kind of infrastructure visualization projects that are currently happening. And this is, I'm not critical, I actually love some of these projects. I'm interested in the work these images are doing versus what I'm going to talk about later, which is the kind of immersive media environments that we're often in. So here's Laura Kurgan's Million Dollar Blocks, reveals new geographies of incarceration. Trevor Paglen's Night Hikes and Telescopic Cameras reveal a dark world at a distance. Eyal Weitzman reveals the architectural shape of a colonized West Bank and the visualities upon which it relies. So, and these are all, like I said, this is one kind of really, really, right now it's really popular to sense and see infrastructure, to bring it, so to speak, into our sensory apperception. The revelation of other worlds, a closed world, a black world, is a familiar gesture, seemingly. Today's 21st century deep mappers reveal worlds in ways perhaps similar to 19th century naturalists like Charles Lyell, who also we spoke about earlier, who plumbed and painted hidden geological systems as an act of, I quote, reading the book of nature, end quote. But one of the questions today is a key difference today in today's revelations, however, is often doom, and that's been discussed previously. And not all the previous projects are doom-like, but certainly like maybe Paglen's we could discuss. Contemporary artistic and scholarly works on hidden infrastructures typically reveal worlds of which we should be wary, worse fates to which we should prepare, or which we should act to correct. If today's infrastructure revelators employ the tools of 19th century naturalists or even Enlightenment science, it's towards a kind of prophetic act of warning sometimes. So there's this sort of maybe apocalyptic form. That these artists are and many designers, maybe they don't even intend to, but are often read as in other fields as doing, that with good enough aesthetics, so to speak, or visualizations or enough data, we could perhaps intervene in the fate of our world. But what if revelation or even bringing things to sensation or knowledge or to light is sort of the wrong metaphor? To whom, after all, have modern infrastructures and large technical systems ever been truly beneath sensation? Looking at the cases closest to site of trauma in recent histories of planetary engineering, we see pictures where figure-ground differentiation are only possible for those least affected by change. So for in this example by Andreas Gursky has been bought up a couple times, it almost feels like it's someone who's not forced by poverty to buy 99-cent goods, who can seemingly take this image and assume that people who do buy 99-cent goods are unconscious of their poverty or don't feel the structural sensations of the infrastructure at all. So so there's a whole series of questions about the work that that kind of imagery is doing. It's as though the photographer is outside the catastrophe of American race, sex, and class political economy, while at the same time being shocked at the ability to reveal these infrastructures. But increasingly, and just to mention a few of the latest events, Flint, Michigan, Fukushima, or the Deepwater Horizon spill to demonstrate a list of recent calamities, it appears that more and more of us are feeling and imaging ecological and economic infrastructures all the time, imaging, visualizing, and feeling, although, of course, always asymmetrically. So that's a key kind of feature. Both the causes are asymmetrical, as has been discussed, but, of course, impacts are asymmetrical as well. And increasingly, we're surrounded by images of these large-scale systems. And these images, I would argue, are hardly like the artistic modes of revelation. Rather, these images are perhaps about the management of perception in shallow spaces of confusion. The Deepwater Horizon is particularly telling. So you watch this live feed of these robots, and you can do nothing, you know, but you can interact with the system. But this is also now become a kind of design. It's part of the big data aesthetic. So this is Songdo. Lots of people who have seen other previous talks know that I've worked for some time here in South Korea at this in the smart city, ubiquitous city development. This is a standard IBM operations research control room. These things are true of, this one is being tested when I was in South Korea, but they have them all over the world, the most prominent one maybe being in Rio to kind of manage supposedly landslides and favelas, but there's all sorts of security, whatever. But what's really interesting about this, so you've got a lot of feeds coming in here. This is an environmental, and this is doing particular levels in the air. There's all sorts of traffic feeds, and there's all sorts of just surveillance systems operating for security. What's interesting is, of course, that all of this is being autonomously analyzed by the algorithms of the system. So, you know, traffic lights are being issued automatically. They're not going through these operators. So the question is, like, what work is all of this doing? And this is a purely performative architecture. That seems to be like increasingly these images are perhaps about the management of perception, as I said, and ways not so much to show us the world as to recruit us to be part of networks where we're kind of engaging or part of a network, but actually no longer have sort of any sort of command over the territory or even any visualization of it. Here's another example that I'm trying to, that is part of my work, which is sort of these new kind of neurocognitive modes. This is Google Glass, but again, you never have a representation of the territory, but in many ways, you're constantly being guided through space, through GIS and GPS systems, and you're sort of on autopilot through these data-driven systems, through a new landscape, if you will, of data. So these are modes of inhabiting space without, if you will, a figure-ground relation, but they're still being directed, but we're still being directed towards action and navigation, and again, you know, territory itself is not really being envisioned in any kind of mode of actual relational, well, you're putting it in relation with many things, but it's, let's just say it's a perhaps a slightly different mode than Charles Lyell's images of geography. So one of the things that combines, so I'm really interested at the work that these two modes of visualization are currently doing, the fetish to see and visualize as with mode of action, and then these kind of immersive environments, they're simultaneously working. And I'm interested in sort of how to think about that now in relationship to more apocalyptic envisioning. So let's take, for example, one of the more recent instantiation of the popular fetishization and visualization of end time scenario panning, the 2011 Rising Current show at MoMA, ironically occurring moments before the real Hurricane Sandy hit. The most the most popular exhibition being one, and is now actually happening, they're actually growing these oyster beds at the tune of $60 million of Rockefeller Foundation money, is the growing of oysters as living barriers or reefs, beautifully rendered here for the show by Escape Studio that came up with this idea, as barriers or reefs. What's remarkable here, of course, is the way that life itself is being recruited as infrastructure. It's kind of nature against nature, if you will. If Ken was here, we could talk about thinking nature without ecology. But anyway, so this recruitment of life itself as infrastructure, not to mention our and other organisms' bodies, so it's not just the oysters, right? We, too, are being recruited into our data infrastructures. Poses serious questions about not only the relation between figures and grounds, and about the, but also about the replacement of revelation by other terms such as management, optimization, and resilience, and the kind of work that those terms are doing right now to envision both as metaphors, but also as actual practices. So there are oyster beds now being grown around Staten Island, and those oysters are unfortunately going to die as a result of their misuse in these dirty waters. And we have to ask, what is at stake in these images and interfaces? More and more, we live in what is previously most known only to those closest to the point of infrastructural violence, the state of catacomb, and I'm borrowing this from Brice Braun's recent work. The idea of the catacomb, as Braun posits it, is existence within permanent crisis management without hope or promise of future redemption. To this end, life itself is being recruited, as with the oysters here, in rising currents to be an infrastructure for real estate speculation, pretty much. And the irony is that, despite all the money, as I mentioned, up to $60 million now of Rockefeller Foundation, the oysters themselves are going extinct as a result of being used under such dirty and inhospitable environments and the rising acidity and temperature of the water that are the result of global warming in general. They're, in short, dying of their own use to maintain the speculation and circulation of capital. This death, however, as we see here, is beautifully rendered in a way that embraces this terminal destruction as pleasurable for us and recruits us into the embrace of this, of basically the destruction of New York, which is what this is depicting. So, I argue, therefore, that the stakes of these images are nothing short of how we wish to inhabit this earth, and that our very future imaginaries of design, technology, and urbanism are still amenable to radical intervention through artistic practice, or aesthetic practice, should I say. In this talk, I'll discuss this contemporary situation a bit about how large-scale infrastructures and cities are being visualized, but also actually built. And then I'll turn to the American architect, theorist, and artist, Libius Woods, to think about some alternatives. And that's where you can help me. I'm not even sure my example is very good, but I'm trying to think about time and the image and so on and so forth. In this talk, I want to talk about temporality and biopolitics of these images and the relationship between this landscape of data and interactivity that coincides with the seeming incommensurable desire to visualize the end, and how these two are working together, if we will, to manage territory, perhaps air, and time. And how do we intervene in this situation where we must both think in terms of landscape and sort of the disappearance, if you will, of certain forms of control through perceptual command over space. Well, we have to produce a politics and ethics, if we will, of radical uncertainty of action without either a sort of enlightened control, but without the return to management strategies, without futurity. And to talk a little bit about inhabiting the catacomb, for a moment, I'm going to talk about this managerial compulsion, this cataconic being that seems to just, I spent a lot of time studying these banal things, smart cities. And this is Sangha, where you saw that operating room coming from. It's in South Korea. And one of the interesting things about this is the way that people talk about it, as, and it's a city of to be built for 300,000 people, as disposable. And it's been grafted out of the ocean, so it's environmentally devastating. But it's a prototype, and it's going to be green. And all of this is all operating at once. That's good. But anyway, so it's a prototype, a test bed, a demo. Its claim to fame is that it's smart or ubiquitous, which is to say there's a heavy computational infrastructure, particularly large fiber optic cables that can get a lot of data into this place. And it's part of a new global infrastructure of territory. It's part of the ancient free economic zone. It's a utopia, so I guess there's some mode of time here. And it's also part, the other two parts of the same free trade zone are very large, one of East Asia's largest airports, and a really, and a new massive shipping facility that's supposed to assist with Busan, which is one of the largest in East Asia as well. These are all also heavily computationally and logistically driven. And it's part of an entire global regime. And you know, Kelly Sterling talks about this as well. But I'm particularly interested in the smart part of it, of these ubiquitous computing territories being rolled out by large computer corporations and leveraged through finance capital from Delhi to Nigeria. What's kind of very interesting to me and what links it back to this whole catacomb thing is the way that this ubiquitous, is the way that bandwidth as in rates of data transmitted per minute or whatever increment of time you want is being equated with the sustainability, perhaps resilience of life itself. So this kind of equation where we kind of responding to this disaster through essentially the penetration of computation and high technology infrastructures to build these like massive compounds that are, I guess, kind of Noah Ark. And what groups these, and this is part of it, we live in a very smart world today. Super smart. There's so many of these things. So there's all sorts of things from secure data centers. This is Pionen in Sweden. It's highly stylized. It's very aesthetic. The other thing, you know, I really don't have time much, but just, you know, all these, everything here is really stylized, even if it looks sometimes cheap and shoddy and off the shelf, and they've used too many, like, cookie cutter forms from Photoshop or something. But what's interesting is that there is a very sleek style. There's obviously an aesthetic experience to all of these things. But what groups together all these smart projects from secure data centers to logistical nodes to Masdar, this is another compound I'm working on with another colleague in outside of Abu Dhabi. It's a supposedly zero carbon footprint city, but basically it didn't work out that well. But so it's ended up just to be a venture capital energy startup. But and it's designed by Foster and partners, and you can see it's kind of sleek, beautiful, hyper space agey, and I've written about that elsewhere. To things like Svelbank, this is a seed bank in Norway to kind of hoard bio stuff, to another location that I've been looking at, which is Gardens by the Bay in Singapore, built by Wilkinson Eyre Architects and Atelier Tan. And what's really interesting is, and by the way, these have you, do you go to the airport in Europe a lot? You'll see these super trees as ads for SAP, which is the world's largest logistics software company. But anyway, that's not an aside. They're always like, the future is here. But what's interesting about this future is that these super trees are much lauded and discussed. So this whole place is a preserve for plant species going extinct, except that most of them can't actually survive in Singapore's actual weather, so that underground there's these huge gardens, but they're being basically refrigerated, so you're like consuming more energy than So you're burning up the earth to, you know, whatever, have this thing. And these super trees, which are highly touted, is working just like trees because they have photovoltaic cells in them that supposedly harness electricity to do things like lighting, but they're also vents, basically, for the building environmental system. So basically, they're just venting out CO2. But anyway, so but beautifully adorned, we are really loving it. And so what is interesting me about all this stuff is this sort of mood of managerial unhopefulness, accompanied with a kind of robust optimism that is sort of shocking. And so basically, you know, what all of these examples inhabit the catacomb, whether and envision these apocalyptic catastrophes, whether terror, you know, whether there's security questions, logistical problems. Songdo was the result of the Asian currency crisis. You know, ecological devastation, and they all inhabit it with this kind of extreme aesthetic of pleasure and a certain optimism. So smartness has become in many ways a new way, a language for negotiating time and space into the immediate present. And it's also an aesthetic and affective space, the space of managing our perceptions and sentiments along with our bodies and sort of abundantly positive. So. As our cities are just being destroyed by rising waters, we literally render these anticipated emergencies as beautiful and desire, even comforting. We embrace death. And of course, this has been said about disaster capitalism. But just to make this point about how positive things are, here's another example from Rising Currents by an architect. As the city of New York is nicely, here comes the water. You have all these nice reefs coming up. And watch the evacuation. You get new waterfront property. And the opening of the show actually says, MoMA and PS1 announced contemporary have joined forces to address one of the most urgent challenges facing the nation's largest city. And this is the catalog line. Sea level rise resulting from global climate change. Though the national debate on infrastructure is currently focused, and I love this evacuation. Just watch. It's very calm, very nice. Can't wait. Storm surge. Here comes the helicopter. Anyway, and this is just, I mean, I'm going to assume that somebody did that with irony, or I don't know. I mean, anyway, so although the national debate on infrastructure is currently, this is at MoMA now, currently focused on shovel-ready projects that will stimulate the economy, we now have an important opportunity to foster new research and fresh thinking about the use of New York City's harbor and coastline. As in past economic recessions, construction has slowed dramatically in New York, and much of the city's remarkable pool of architectural talent is available to focus on innovation. So not only do we have this, thank God we've had this economic crisis, now there's all those unemployed architects that can work on this. Total boon. Anyway, so this wonderful thing. So in fact, so we're speculating on hope of these massive forms of extinction and death. And so one of the questions, as we've talked, is what forms of image making will intervene between this sort of seamless kind of representation, if you will, of the future, that's already coming with the also already immersive way we're being attuned to these environments, as you know, as I discussed. If there's a feature to this emerging landscape, it's that there's a sensorial element, a disappearance, as I said, of figure-ground relations. Entire landscapes either bought into buildings or literally resculpted as massive-scale spatial products. And here's just some other examples of where, and I'm really interested in sort of the dual logic of kind of containment, how things both get contained and simultaneously you have this sort of hyper-compression and of kind of interiority and exteriority of kind of confusion. So the two things are working together. This is MVRDV's projection for this another complex in South Korea where you actually see the environments are being brought into the building, also visible very much in their current development in Rotterdam, this market hall, and I was recently there, just to play through the renderings of the way this is working. So these are maximum density place spaces that are literally building, they're bringing environments into buildings, and they come accompanied, so there's literally sort of this infinite sweeps of marketing strategies that fly through scale, and the new demonstrations of sort of ecological space. And I'm kind of trying to think about this in terms of like previous presentations like Reynolds, where one asks how simultaneously the elimination of these figure-ground relations relates to the bounding of territory air. So I like MVRDV very often, but how is the disappearance, how is this environment being accompanied with a kind of rise of fortress Europe and other things that are simultaneously happening within a media condition that largely already integrates our bodies, even our nervous systems, into populations and clouds that are being modulated. So it's almost like we're looking at different scales of this phenomena, right, from the Google Glass into this kind of remarkable, constantly like immersive environment and flexible space. And that gets replayed out also in the kind of marketing of these smart cities. And I'll just play the Songdo ad as we go. So what interests me, so here, we're looking at both this seemingly, this operation together, the seeming incommensurability of visualizations of both revelation and interaction occurring at numerous scales simultaneously. So the ads for Songdo envision a sort of plastic territory that directly parallels the financing, if you will, by Morgan Stanley, the depth swapping and the geoengineering. This thing was literally scraped out of the ocean at massive cost to the environment, that sustain this particular development as a coherent spatial product. And what interests me in all these architectures of pleasureful destruction parametrically rendered to smooth away the capacity to encounter the impossibility of witnessing such a disaster, but rather moving us away from the encounter with a radical difference of the earth or the environment, or more critically of the other beings that are suffering, to make this pleasant space of capital possible. Recalling the oysters again, in place of thus we have design and all these beautiful fly-throughs and totally sweet spaces. So, but at the same time, calling the oysters, you know, these are entirely destructive environments, and they literally channel our attention into capital through the production of spaces that deliberately confuse interiority and exteriority down to our very kind of neural nets, that compress landscape into the prototype and circulate capital, as I mentioned, through endless credit debt swaps. So it's as though we've lost our senses, literally. We cannot see or apprehend that which is before us, where the world is infinitely malleable and scalable, as you saw from all those kind of fly-throughs in different scales. So this sort of condition, this kind of combinatorial condition of this kind of malleability of interiority and exteriority combined with a kind of relentless seeming drive of capital to build these complexes brings up sort of certain questions, along with this kind of apocalyptic hopefulness, brings up kind of questions about, so what would a less deadly image look like? Is that how to, like how, and you know, and one of the people I've been thinking this through, but I don't know if this is the right example, is, you know, is the architect, theorist and designer Lebius Woods. I've done some work with in his archive, but you know, I could think of many other good examples, better examples, maybe Theaster. I mean, there are many other people, but one of the reasons that I like Woods is that essentially he is the kind of architect, if you will, of catastrophe. He is somebody who has taken up the question, who perhaps offers some thinking about what designing an architecture, about what creating a design or architectural practice, or even a humanities practice, is that recognizes not that the catastrophe is to come, but perhaps that it's already here. Most of the animals are extinct, and most of humanity lives in misery. But so the question should then perhaps move away from this neoliberal compunction to survive, which always then mandates the ongoing penetration of these kind of infrastructures into our environment, to the question of how do we wish to live. And so I want to turn to his work for a minute. So as I mentioned, Woods is the architect of catastrophe. He provided vistas of rent territories. He never really built very much of anything. I mean, there's one thing in China. But whether geological events, wars, or simply fictive futures of seemingly post-catastrophic life, he always attempted to talk about or think about kind of possible futures without destroying time. Wood's approach centered often on the concept of what he called hybrid landscapes. He urged architects to think about the fact that architecture is in nature. Buildings are artificial, perhaps, artificial, but they are the environments we inhabit, and the design of single buildings has broad consequences and must be framed as processes, not discrete spaces by their designers and everyone involved in their realization. In the projection of the future of a city destroyed by ethnic conflict, for example, Woods envisions spaces cut through vectors that will never obscure the past. He talks about everything as a wound or a scab. They don't really heal, but they do move. They facilitate new capacities in the infrastructure, new directions for connections between space. Woods also did a series of, and here's another example. Woods also did series of projects on geological events, the San Francisco and Haiti quakes. Woods suggests here a geotechnical approach within which earthquakes and faults are imagined in their constant movement as an architecture. For him, denying the restlessness of the earth creates death. We must fight here, give the Cartesian orthogonal plane of a house that makes them killers when earthquakes strike. So he envisioned drawing another landscape. So one of the questions is sort of asking about our given assumptions about what constitutes stability and how we're thinking about form. In all his work, he actually never separated between war, architecture, and nature. As he said in inspiration from a Japanese architect, and I quote, earthquakes are like wars, and architecture's war. It is a battle to reassert the human over nature. But his mandate, he argued, was to change the terms of the war, to think otherwise, to assume that no event is ever natural. Or rather, that they are all natural. He suggests an architecture that is landscape, in his words, is a heterarchy grounded in quantum theory, which he often drew inspiration from, and cybernetics, a sort of concept of self-organization, but not the kind of fantasy of a data-driven self-organizing city without a government, but rather that of vectors of multiple temporalities, a reassemblage. In his word, he used the terms construction, not conservation of spaces that creates what he called new free spaces, roaming global territories that not instate a non-space, but rather questions of affiliation between spaces and times. And you can kind of see this in his kind of effort to render or draw or think what kind of an alternative mode of territoriality. He evinces a comprehension that disaster has happened, but this is not the tabula rasa of modernity to which we must respond with a false optimism of progress, but rather to territory with a memory as though a body, a wound, but one that also heals. Architects, he argued, but I would include all of us, cannot think otherwise, he said, than in that of the valorous mode. Because in order to think otherwise demands a practice of gesture and of the body, to take drawing and image making as material acts just like pouring concrete. Drawing for him was not a failure to build, he argued. Rather, it is a diagram of thought. So he wrote about drawing that it was not against practice. His sketches are about the future tense of practice, about what it means not to rebuild or conserve, but to radically reconstruct a landscape. And he wrote, drawing is the tool of the architect on the move, on the run. The architect is, first of all, a citizen of a stricken city, and then you dynamic instability. And so one of his questions was sort of, how does one think aesthetically and ethically about radical instability, which is, you know, an unknowability in that sense, without kind of having a sense of your final form. Drawing, in his world, is the medium of a world that is mobile. It is not analogous to creating blueprints in architecture. These are sketches, if you will, sketches that demonstrate impermanence and allow architectural concepts that are fluid and changing. So they're diagrams of thought, which he took very much from Deleuze. The enactment of a possibility for the world to be remade, though, is through instability and through actually not being really clear of your perspective, that the point is not to gain purchase on top of territory, but to be embedded within the environment. So I'm kind of thinking about this in my head in comparison to these immersive media environments where we also kind of have perceptual loss of, but still trying to create ways, and maybe we could have a conversation with our earlier talks about kind of the forms of image making or the necessity of translation as a mode of moving oneself out of the immediate space or time of the environment in order to also act differently within it. And so I think there's an interesting conversation to be had there between all these papers. So here, landscape becomes the tool to reconfigure the hubris of technology conquering nature, and rather opens up the body of the city or the person to time and to the fact that these wounds are connections between all of us alive on the earth. So he's constantly talking about this because it is a connection between all of us, because in his words, within this destruction of war of environment, one injects our desire. So it's not to repeat, like everything remains destroyed, it's to inject a new form of desire into this destruction. This injection, this demonstration of the wounds of what he labels scabs or trauma, renders spaces open, vectors to other times that recall history, reconstruct it, not an attempt to resurrect or return to some mythic past, not to rebuild the old world, but to envision a new one to come. And for this reason, he really maintains that discourse of injury, but also healing. So Woods was particularly shaped by the end of the Cold War and the subsequent Civil War in the Balkans. He spent time in Zagreb and Sarajevo in the early 90s, and he opened his work on post-war Sarajevo with these quotes. "Every age has its own face." These are quotes of people he's. "The face of ours is a savage one. Delicate spirits cannot confront it. They swerve their eyes in terror. They invoke the ancient prototypes. They cannot look directly at the contemporary prodigious and dreadful spectacle of a world in painful birth." And the other quote he opens this work on is, "Sarajevo is the first city of the 21st century. The message we send back to you is not a happy one, but we are alive." In Sarajevo, Woods argues, one recognizes the loss of figure ground relations, of losing identities, of the inability to plan because of constant shifts of terror. And in facing the destruction of the city and its constant impermanence, the architect he argues must respond with new institutions. He imagined a new parliament made of free spaces woven through the surviving, in his words, Cartesian framework of the older modernist parliamentary buildings. Similar projects which it reflects. And there's a moment in his diary that I just want to end with. So the best evokes his effort to think the unthought, to encounter the terrible reality that is the fate of most of us on Earth. In a series of letters imagined to his lovers, perhaps his final partner, Alexandra Wagner, he opens, "I recall a summer," and I quote, "we had no names," end quote. He implies no identities, no stable bodies or conscious state. He writes about state changes and seeing his lover sleeping, but thinking she was awake and kissing her and bringing her to consciousness. And he writes these recollections, or maybe fictions, near drawings of topographies of mounds and landscapes that you can see here, that depict a nowhere, at once familiar, mountains that could be cities or perhaps bodies. And he writes to this woman, maybe real, maybe in a dream, "Finally, I return. Finally, time and space compress between us." And again, you see these kind of images, and also a lot of problems, actually, with putting his thoughts to language. By compression, I don't mean they become less, so it's definitely not like the current logistical systems. Rather, he wrote, they become more, more intense. And he continues, "By world, I do not refer to geography unless it is a mapping of pain. Rather, imagine how a matrix of fierce energy and the memories and words are blacked out here, perhaps a failure of expression that opens perhaps the desire to draw." So there's this wonderful relationship in these diaries between the kind of creation of these new territories and the language itself of the diary that opens to the desire to draw and still connect to this other body. And he imagines this, that these burning memories. And at the side of these drawings, these images, as though necessary flights beyond the page, perhaps to compensate for what he cannot write, or perhaps as a dialogue in search of connection between words and images, between territories, and between the bodies of lovers. It's all done in a hotel room in London, and it envisions a fragmented world, perhaps one where time and space are rethought. And it's done while he had been in Zagreb, but was kind of now kind of contemplating the violence from a distance. And when he continues, he said, "I do not refer to geography as a mapping of pain. Rather, I imagine now a matrix of fierce energy." And he finally completes with, "By enough, I do not imagine that desire can ever be satisfied. Where are you?" The drawing that accompanies this statement is a turbulent geography, one with new vectors, always seeking others that cannot consume or locate, creating unfulfilled desires. Again, a sort of kind of impasse, perhaps genuinely an impasse of translation with this woman. A world full of pain, but always invoking the desire to live and to encounter others, animals, beings, humans, who will produce energy for the world to come, energy to find love. And Wood's efforts to find his lover, who has no name, to encounter this geography, returns us to the idea that a new image, one that does not posit control over the earth or over destiny, but still envisions another way to connect between time, spaces, and each other, may yet open the possibility to envision a future that is not catastrophic, an image of how we must survive. Not an image of how we must survive, but how we might want to live. These words in his diary become the opening passage to a text titled Architecture and War. In it, he does not turn away from war. He says, rather, architecture and war are not incompatible. Architecture is war. War is architecture. I'm at war with my time, with history, with all authority. I'm one of millions who not fit, who have no home. I'm an architect, a constructive world essentialist who worships the flesh, the melody. I cannot know your name, nor can you know mine. Tomorrow we begin together the construction of a city. In this final act, he seeks to both recognize violence and refuse its continuation, to think technically, but to accept heterogeneous time and difference, to find new ways to love the world and perhaps each other, to which the image is always the site of possibility and disaster.
Okay, so much here. So I'll try to thank you both, though I shouldn't be thanking you. It's hard to choose one question from the many I could ask. So what I'll try to do is make two broad but brief points and then try to introduce a question that kind of touches on, to different degrees, sort of latent threads in your talk that I'd like you to pull, and I would love to hear you answer. And hopefully these will resonate with earlier discussions from past panels too. And the first I should perhaps mention comes from the perspective of somebody in my case who's in some ways it's a very unnatural condition of being a digital native natural, of course, sharing etymologies, but who's also working and thinking from much earlier periods. I'm now teaching and writing on 17th and 18th. Centuries. So the first are two sort of foundational questions for early modernity that seem to be foregrounded but haven't yet been named and underlying a lot of our earlier discussions, particularly in Emily's case, which is first the question of how to organize a knowledge, what counts as knowledge, what are its limits, which of course in digital revolution has very different contours, but it's a question that sort of hasn't left us since the 16th century. In the 18th, we seem to settle somewhere, but now it's hard to know where we are. The second is a very important question to ask in this room and in a school of architecture. The question of can we think without language? How do we think without language? It's a question Can We Think Without Language is a title. I think that's the title of a book of conversations between Posen-Park and Philippe Soler. And that question seems to have been underlying a lot of earlier analyses of visual materials too. And now the more direct question, which is if we accept that we literally us here and now can imagine an end to life as it is known, human or otherwise, in unprecedentedly secular ways, in other words, outside of religious or messianic, eschatological, apocalyptic in the revelatory sense, narratives, then this begs the question of what sort of subject does this condition forge, right? Whether we want to name it anthropocenic or not. And now to go to your titles, is overburdened one answer, Emily? And in your case, Orit, is resiliently hopeful or helplessly or hopelessly hopeful another answer to this question of what subjects are forged? And then I wanted to also introduce a question about how to reconcile and sort of translate across the different temporal scales at play in both of your fields, I suppose, between the sort of the urgency of urban environmental pressures and the immediacy of communication technologies, right? Both of which sort of are temporal compressions, but still at very different and at times incompatible scales. I'll leave it at that. I'd also love to hear you two react to each other, and then we'll reopen up.
A few thoughts. I'm not sure. I mean, there's a lot in play here. I'm not going to respond directly, but maybe get to your points. But one thing that it seemed to me was coming through our both of our talks was this, the dumbness of smartness.
Right.
It's on the one hand a kind of blind baby capitalism, right? That's just, that follows its drive to get an outcome, right? It just, it goes to product. And it snakes through the episteme and doesn't really acknowledge it. You know, I mean, I know that sounds kind of heavy-handed Marxist reading, but I think there is, on some level, you sort of lift the hood on these lexicons, and they kind of say what they mean. You know, but then you get this meta level of the education industry that sort of grabs onto outcome-driven research, and I mean, these aren't particularly original points, but I think we can make one kind of critique very easily. What we're not actually doing is the sort of translational archaeology that gets us to that place, and then it gets quite complex. There are great uses of data mining. Sure, there are, of course. You know, I can think of there are plenty of them in my own areas of research for large translational corpora. In a longer version of this, I've kind of developed some of that. So this isn't a knee-jerk anti-tech kind of thing, but I think that the question of the imbrication, and I think yours linked to this, that behind every utopian vision of a smart building, what's coming out the other end is some friendly handshake to an extractive industry that is then also, in a sense, retranslating itself into a knowledge apparatus, and catching hold of that in real time, and in a sense practicing a critique politically, is quite tricky. And I think that this kind of smart dumb pairing, strangely, is ghosted by something that came up in your talk, which you didn't really develop. Maybe you can in the discussion, which is the catch-on. Which is, as far as I understand it, is a theological term for the nomos that's developed by Schmidt and Kelsen and all these people. It's a very, very, very complex thing. You didn't even define it. So I did want to press you on that.
Okay,
that just went whoop, and I'm like, I don't understand what you're using that term to refer to.
I was using it directly through Bruce Brown's work, and I'm actually kind of torn about using it at all. I don't actually particularly like Schmidt, and I don't know if I really want to go back to the kind of nomos feature. I like this idea of kind of an eternal crisis management state without a particular endpoint vision, but I'm not sure, and I'm not sure that I want to take the whole, so I mean, I'm glad you're pushing me on it, and it's something I'm kind of testing the waters about, sort of whether this set of urban planners that's taking it up is, you know, like what they're trying to accomplish, I think, is a kind of effort to negotiate the question of both violence and vulnerability as a constant state without release, and to make interventions to kind of use that term against or with, or to somehow temper this other term of resilience, which is essentially like a neat, is kind of this malleable language for constantly facilitating change while not changing social relations or relations to other things in the world. And so it's this incredibly carnivorous and cannibalistic.
Psychotherapeutic.
But it also comes out of C.S. Holling in the 70s, out of environmental population ecology, where he kind of started looking at populations in terms of systems instead of individuals. And so what was important was the system's ability to continue to operate, like kind of maintain some sort of ontological being consistently, even if many things were killed in it, so that you could kind of keep things moving without absolute numbers. So in that sense, I think this idea is underdeveloped, because my use of it is coming from these other urban planners and not from the entire kind of history of political,
especially theory. History of law and
yes.
and the messianic dimension of that.
Well, the messianic though is something I would love to develop more with you in conversation or with the room. So, because I keep going in and out of use of envisioning is there some sort of, in the way that science isn't really never separate from religion, is there some kind of secularized apocalyptic vision that popularizes, that still has the question of temporality about the apocalypse, like its inevitability, its kind of morality. I mean, one of the issues is kind of about the kind of moral goodness of getting onto Singapore and being in this island and being rescued from the where others can't, and then that fits with all sorts of capitalist class questions. Part of what I'm trying to figure out is, you know, a lot of people are like, no, I want to talk about catastrophe or disaster instead, like Tim Morton, like in terms of management and stay away from the apocalypse. But sometimes I'm wondering, or I'm trying to think about, maybe it is apocalyptic, the modes of management that are being invoked, because they're invoking the inevitability temporally, the kind of moral valences that come with a kind of theological element. So
this may not be directly relevant, but I thought as an interesting example, I don't know if you've read the novel Dahlgren by Samuel Delaney. Which is this incredible dystopia. Talk about the analysis of atmosphere and air, and it's an interesting 1970, right?
Yeah.
Survivalist, and the whole question of the languages that grow up and the communities and how they create habitats in these, and nobody knows what's been destroyed or not, and they don't know why what the catastrophe was. And this leads to this larger question of, I mean, I've only heard now implicitly about the air, but like where is the catastrophe and where is the sovereign state? This dislocated quality, which is takes a lot, really messes with a lot of the messianistic paradigms of apocalypse, because it's basically an all over diffused apocalypsm that lives in the air or is in, you know, partial buildings, but people have become so disoriented that they no longer can really fully distinguish between what's a normative space for habitat and what is not.
That's very helpful for me just in terms of thinking about whether or not to play it, because it's definitely one of the interesting things about thinking about the technosphere, like the reverse side of the Anthropocene, which I guess people are calling like the technosphere or whatever, is there's so many spheres and scenes. But I think it's really key to develop them is this question of the specific type of work, ubiquitous computing, which also does in literate studies, to kind of disperse also, not only responsibility, but also it brings in all sorts of questions of like, where is the translation happening? Where is sites of value being produced? Where is that actually happening? And sometimes it's creating crises around that, as in 2008, where people are like, I didn't know what to do.
Should we go to... So who has questions? Okay. Maybe do you guys mind if we collect a couple?
And then, not so many that we can't remember them.
Right, we'll do a couple.
It's
Thank you, and thank you for two fantastic talks. I really enjoy this kind of call to think about the materiality of these kind of metaphors. And through both your talks, I was kind of thinking about Minecraft and the kind of, you know, this is like the biggest game and, you know, it's, you know, all these things are kind of powered by coal fire computers. And it seemed like that's the prism house of a kind of computational logic where you can make all these worlds, but they're sort of within this, you know, but we're also teaching a whole sort of generation to mine and these kind of metaphors of mining. And sort of in contrast to that, I was thinking about the way in which, I mean, I found Blanchot's work on fossils and the fragment really useful for thinking about geology and the kind of how you resist making a world. And I got that from those images of the architects sort of, you know, but you can't actually make that world, you know, that, you know, you don't get very many buildings built and so on. So there's kind of how we stay with the fragment and with the kind of, you know, sort of persistence with that fragment and a resistance to world making and what the kind of politics of that might be. So it's kind of question, comment, but thank you.
It's really, there are many questions. I was just talking to Robin earlier. I mean, I'm actually involved in another project, which is trying to imagine, articulate what the matter of politicking is. It's very complex. It can either organize itself into familiar allegories of campaigns, targeting your enemy, and become kind of like a video game, or it can be sort of British House of Cards, where it's Macbeth and King Lear. You know, they're familiar outlines, but there's a lot of fuzzy stuff that is actually intangible. It's like the atmosphere. It's unlocatable, and it sometimes comes through in the filming of a parliamentary procedure that just goes on and on and on, or some diffuse kind of random action in the atmosphere that becomes suddenly a conduit for fortuna or for kairos, you know, something to happen. And it's, so I think the larger question here is really the incalculability of what is the material. And when you get it into the linguistic, don't treat language as some sort of pure kind of semiosis, but as something that also has a materiality and an immateriality. Then you're beginning to open up a whole range of heuristic questions that allow for comparisons that weren't made before. Like if I described that I was talking about mining and language mining, I'm not just doing a metaphor. I'm not. You know, that's not the point, really, although it's fun. It's fun to kind of see that these things pop out at you, and if you're a close reader, it's sort of begs to be explicated. But that's actually not what really interests me so much. It's really this larger question of the how does one is in a prison house of language, of course. We were talking earlier too about Quentin Meillassoux's idea of the great outdoors. Well, sure, the correlations thing. Let's try to think thinking without beyond thinking without human thought. Well, you can't. You know, and everyone says, well, I know you can't. But there's this still this question of the limit of something that's, say, cognitively material or perceptively material. And that, and then, of course, you get into language, which is also material.
I'm not sure if I fully grasp the entire, although I'm thinking about the implications of your question. I mean, I'm interested about this other, I'm one interested in this question of material because it's sort of all action, I mean, it's all creating action. And then I'm interested in this idea of your resistance to world making, which I'm not sure it's so much a resistance to world making as like a resistance to like world suturing. Or something like, because in some sense, as people have been talking about throughout this conference, there's always this like first stab in an intervention and even a lot in somehow opening the possibility of a future, a different world to people at all, like to even envision that, and that's the first kind of step towards making a different one, and that there's something for me. And I think that's why I was struggling with Lebius Woods, which isn't what I normally study, you know, just those big, ugly, smart cities and their histories, actually, mostly history. But I was trying to struggle to think about this fact that there's a lot of visualization action going on right now. But, you know, the question of imaginary infrastructures is much harder to bring into design
both in practice and even in theory, and that like speculative design tends to be like figure out what Facebook will look like in 2 days, you know, not but really that is what 90% of speculative design is, and you know, trying to get away from versioning and prototyping. Even like these cities are being versioned and prototyped at massive scales, but they're seen as like disposable spatial products, basically, for the next better version that's going to be data driven. So for me, I guess it's not so. I'm interested in that question of resistance to immediacy, which is always comes up, the deferral or difference at all sorts of different materialities, both linguistic, but also in these other sets of modes of expression, I guess, or articulation of what the world might be. And I'm interested in heterogeneity, temporal heterogeneity in practice, and how that gets maintained. Like that you can both answer to the present, but at the same time, need to have all these other modalities operative at the same time. I don't know if that answers anything.
I have a 5 second, just point of fact question for Emily that others that think in languages other than English might also be thinking about. It occurs to me that actually the metaphors from mining in Portuguese don't refer to digital data. They actually, their semantic field is one of closer to undermining and sort of weakening, which could have could have all sorts of implications. So minar. So, and there is no equivalent, actually. So is that English, or do you see that across other European languages? Just if you could give us a quick panorama of data mining and digging and its translations.
Let's see. Well, in French, it's certainly in the same sense.
It is in the same sense.
Mm-hmm. I mean, offhand, okay. I think it's pretty consistent.
Okay.
And you know, that's why even the Latin root for
ferro
is iron or steel, iron, it's translated to mm-hmm.
Interesting. Okay. There's a verb.
But the larger point is how all these questions shift through languages. That's the whole thing there.
What that tells us potentially.
It was a side point, but that's really interesting.
Right. Yeah. Okay, so we have a few more. So yes.
Okay. Well, I really enjoyed those presentations because I actually feel like they're really good to think with, and particularly because I feel like in a lot of this work, when we grapple with explanatory frameworks for these conditions, we often fall back on capitalism as a kind of totalizing system of, you know, production and material reproduction and so on. But you know, it seems like Wood's work and other work that you're pointing to really reminds us that these kind of spasmodic episodes of worlding and deworlding and spectacular violence and things like that are not at all reducible to kind of imperatives of capital. I mean, there's a lot of other things going on in the world, and I wonder if you could, you know, maybe sort of speculate or talk a little bit about what these other things might be that are beyond or below or outside of capital, because capital is, of course, a limited system of operation, and there are many other things at stake in what you're talking about. What are the other vectors of control and conditioning that are going on?
I wouldn't know. I'm in them. He suggests a lot of things that like people are suggesting around like geological. I mean, he's suggesting that there are all sorts of forces that are operating at different timescales than the limited timescale of industrial production or what have you. I think there's also the reverse suggestion that, and this is what dumbness or smartness opens along with the term Anthropocene, which is that capital itself is constituted of a lot of agents that have to come together. So, you know, there's a lot of ways, I guess I use capital as shorthand, but, you know, these urban environments or whatever large-scale infrastructure you want to talk about is not a pre-existing thing. And one of the things that interests me is the way these systems do fold on themselves. You actually pointed this out initially. You know, the idiosyncrasy between this this tech, like the fact that Sangdo looks like a Corbusian, like square city, you're like, why did they build it in this old scale, in this old form that they, like, why was that the vision when, you know, and the guys at Cisco told me that it doesn't really matter what the city looks like.
Right.
For the infrastructure, so like, why'd you pick that boring city? You could have done circles, you could have done whatever. And part of that is their previous historical imaginary about what a futuristic city would look like,
yep.
combined with, but then overlaid on all these other assemblages of different things coming in from different places, and then those things end up not working the way anybody anticipates them to. And so tactically, of course, there's a lot of places to look at the opportunity that's offered in that layering. So it's about, I think, also making capital a constantly unstable entity that is always about these kind of tactical relations or whatever, and that there's therefore all sorts of interventions. And for me, the main one is to think also about modes of envisioning futures beyond replicating these particular forms.
We're rolling out. One of the meanings of the catch-on is withdrawal.
Yeah.
I think that's another imaginary at this point, whether it's, I mean, it's linked to quietism, to retreat from the political, from off the grid, from various forms of instructional strategies, I will prefer not to, a whole vocabulary of obstruction of obstruction.
Mm-hmm.
Those are some of the things one might think about.
Or maybe capitalism is a religious practice and a theology and
messianic.
Yeah.
So now let's collect. How are we doing? We're pressed for time. So let's collect three questions. That you don't have the mic. Oh.
I have the mic. I'm going to try and make this really quickly. Thank you both for fantastic talks. Reinhold, the last night, he said there was a phantom in the room, and I wondered if I'd like to evoke what I think is perhaps another phantom, and it has a dual logic, which is the military. On the one hand, the environmental catastrophe of militarization and the militarization of environmental catastrophe. And we know now that militarization is probably the single greatest cause of environmental devastation. And yet I think it's been ghosted. And I'm wondering if, just to throw out, I don't know how else to ask this, if you would like to address the phantom, the ghost of militarization. And what I think is that the apocalypse really is here right now, and that most people on the planet are already living in it. And if you could perhaps address questions of ruination, pleasurable destruction, infrastructure, in terms of militarization.
Yeah, let's take it.
I'd actually rather hear a response than my question.
It's almost like I spend so much of my time writing about securitization, usually, that but one of the things I wanted to say about militarization is I don't think it's the ghost in the room, but I think like capital, it needs to be complicated. That there's still this problem, like Marxian, you know, whatever, man, women, and animals must make, you know, futures under conditions not of our choosing. And there are many questions, you know, the question about the inevitability of whether the fact that a technology comes from a militarized, or a set of tactics come from a militarized parent, so to speak, decrees their future, I think is where we need to be thinking about the intervention, because I'm not ready to see that just because it's all militarized, it will always be militarized, like that it will just get more relentless. And so I find, so A, everything you say is totally right. I mean, this is there's such a combination of tactics and all this organizational management and cybernetics and everything that come from military origins. although we could always complicate what the military is, because the military has also always been corporate and academic and other things. But also, you know, I think Woods is pretty strong on thinking military devastation. I mean, the whole purpose of invoking him is that he's the architect of saying the catastrophe is here. It's not coming. It has already happened and is continuing to happen. And in invoking the sort of question about sort of how you're going to negotiate war and still envision another future, which is very, very he's very specific about that in both War and Architecture and in all his long-term kind of visits to the Balkans during the Civil War, as well as his work afterwards. So for him, a lot of it is about keeping up that trauma as invoked into all those insertions into the buildings and the idea of like vectors and sort of really taking up languages of how bodies have to deal with physical wounding. In order to think about, so he wants to kind of create, and he's pretty open also that we need new parliamentary, we need new institutional structures that you know, in other places where he's thinking a lot about decolonization or other forms of colonial violence that we could call military, I suppose. You know, I think he's very open about attempting to figure out how to rework those histories without abolishing them, but without returning to some other nostalgic vision of like the state or, you know, so I don't know if that's answering your question, except then, you know, a really long history of cybernetics.
Just a short history of the military and language. I think we forget that, first of all, that the study of languages in the U.S. Was sparked by Sputnik, post-Sputnik, and got a huge oomph from the military. And, of course, after 9/11, the same thing happened, where suddenly we had to have a speaker Pashto and things like that. So there's that whole way in which those two spheres just directly interact us. But then there's also the fact that it's been very, very much a force behind the technologizations of language and their reduction. So machine translation, which used to be a joke, is actually getting really good. But it started often very much with these machines now that they use on military fields so that they can translate languages. It's like you don't just point and shoot with your weapon, but there is like a literal weaponization of the translation machine as you are in a field of combat. There's all kinds of stuff like that, which is, I don't know how you group it under your question, but I think it's all related.
It is all related. I think that for me, though, as a historian, the difficult thing is also to try to understand the different organization, though, of this violence at every historical moment, because all of this is happening, but at the same time, the U.S. military is all working through subcontractors, and I mean, even Snowden demonstrated the CIA, you know, so there's a different organization of that knowledge and power that is also worth tracking, that certainly informs all these things.
So I just wanted to draw or read out or maybe try to pin you down on the question of hope and the messianic. And I think, you know, what your talk did for me in part was just render really vivid this question of hope for whom. And I think in particular, you know, that scene where the flood comes and the thing automatically goes up, and then there's this little helicopter that comes and picks up like two people off the top of the buildings, right?
You can buy insurance now that will fly you off to like a vacation. when in indeed, the waters rise.
And of course, in that rendering, you don't see the people in Sheepshead Bay or Red Hook who are already living with the apocalypse. But I guess it's a more personal question about hope and the messianic. I think a lot of the figures of hope you offered us were sort of in that ironic kind of move, like these things are actually kind of like not worth hoping for at all. But it, you know, to draw you out or pin you down, like do you cast your lot with someone like Derrida, who's all about Derrida? So, you know, messianicity without messianism, literally expecting the unexpected, refusing to pin your hope on any specific figure of a future to come, or, you know, do you have a rendering? Do you have a figure of hope that is worth hoping for?
I think I'm struggling with that question. I think that's like a collective problem, right? Like we're trying to generate here, like some set of language, thought, tactics, whatever we want to call, by which we can envision that future, that difference, without returning to, like, you know, nice modernist, like, here's the one utopia, let's go, reassuring though that may be. So yes, I mean, so that's the only answer, is that I don't have one. What I am concerned about, and perhaps didn't articulate well enough, since this is a really early set of thoughts that I'm just struggling through really hard and new materials, is the combination between the kind of, you know, like the MVRDV, like fly-through is really great. It's like this beautiful thing. You're going in and out. There's like all these fruits and vegetables, and it's going to rethink the space of Rotterdam while that port stays totally cordoned off from, you know, is the way that we're living in these immersive, and that on one hand we're being directly, I mean, they want to, the Google, you know, they have all those marketing things now, they're like checking out your eye movements, and like, you know, it's going to be really like people want to jack it in, you know. So you're on one hand, you have no image whatsoever because you're just in an affective space all the time of kind of just hooking up. On the other hand, you are being still fed. Representation's not gone away. And so you're trying to figure out what work that's doing. You know, how are these visualizations or images intervening in this immersive architecture? And you're trying to look at the space, the incommensurability, which you initially asked me, between the different temporalities that are operating at different scales, many of which don't exactly slide onto one another. Like, you know, massive scale systems like finance or meteorology don't operate directly at the time or speed of my body. And so you're having all these things going on, and you're trying to look for places in there where you can activate that would perhaps open us in a Derridean way to kind of envisioning a supplement to the world that is beyond resilience, which is the discourse that colonizes right now design and architecture. So I don't know if that answered anything.
Who wants to have the last word? Okay, so yeah, with that...
There's one last question.
Should we have...
Should we could...
Yeah, let's have one more.
I could wait for more, so. Okay, yeah.
Well, I'll get it.
Yeah, so my question is also very much related to militarization and more thinking about fields and battlefields of knowledge and the relationship between science and vision, which was already mentioned before. My question is, can you envision some sort of landmine, like a minefield of knowledge?
Perhaps, like, I've been tracing this personally myself, like these could be seen through patterns that are more evident within, like, let's say, cryptographic epistemologies, but also thinking about how through the minefield, the underground, which is often exiled because it's a place where inhabited by waste, or that we cannot see, or we often forget by thinking that the earth is still flat through many relationships with the strata of thought and earth and all of these things. So can it be epistemological? If yes, how do you think so? Another, I have a comment on the carceral domestic space, which also in a way chimes with Joanna's presentation. The person who, Ibn al-Haytham, like the pioneer in the 10th century, 11th century, who first attested to the, like, the pinhole camera phenomenon, was the first person also who calculated the height of the Earth's atmosphere, which is in the 11th century, which is the same as today, like 79 kilometers. But he did this while he was held under house arrest. So he was inside of a prison, which was also a house, which was turned into a lab. So then here we see some interesting relationship between seeing the air, which in a way he was studying the reflection of light within the air, and photography. And then we go back to the underground, because in the underground up until now, like, it's as if it's the place where photography is impossible. So thinking about knowledge vision and the act of exhuming
mining, and also this abeyant knowledge, which is under the underground. The second question is for Orit. Do you think, like, do you see reconstruction as a messianic strategy, especially that in the case of the work of Woods, where what we see that is being tangibly retained and fixated is the moment of danger itself? Is this, like, the messianic? Okay. I had other questions, but it doesn't matter.
Well, the landmine, that's a tricky one because it's both a landmine's on the surface of the earth, but it's also subterranean, which is why, again, we've got this real problem of metaphoric slippage, right? Are we talking about a cognitive architecture that is to do with the resemblance, even if it's a sort of architectural or infrastructural one, between thinking and mining, or production of thinking as it is produced through writing, say, or editing, or researching, and mining, and you know, and even the term as you were speaking, a landmine. That's such an incredibly resonant metaphor. So a landmine, of course, is a landmine, but it's also I thought you were alluding to their more modern use as in a battlefield, right? In a sense, the question shifts to something I didn't really examine. I was looking at mining in terms of, you know, sort of how one might construe an understanding of the overburden that it produces, but it's also that it produces death. I mean, it produces explosions, it produces unexpected, it's a form of weaponization. So those are like vastly different things, but it goes to show you that every time you think you're doing a kind of material analysis, you can't keep it clean from these sort of slippages.
Well, all I have to say is what a beautiful reading of Woods you've done. So this idea of tangibly retaining the moment of danger is a messianism intrigues me in terms of thinking about whether we could push that in terms of thinking about his drawings, but maybe just other practices of whenever we're forced to deal with reconstructing a destroyed space, where you both are attempting to figure out like the kind of mode of living in it, but at the same time sort of keeping through time a moment of danger that both accedes the fact that it's already happened, so that you don't always have just the apocalypse is coming, survivalist mode. You have like something happen, but at the same time, the idea of kind of a certain form of vulnerability maintained as a certain, maybe as a guide or a warning or as some sort of relationship to permanence and impermanence and change.
To make one last comment on this, I think what, you know, you alluded to the securitization. I mean, what it leads to instead of hope is prophylactism, where you're simply trying to, you can't anticipate everything, so you're just more and more towards it's that movie Safe, right? You're simply, you're returned to ground, or you're returned to degree zero of existence because everything's so risky. Anything is a risk. And therefore, you return to pure stasis.
I mean, that's the inverse possibility. I mean, I think it's reflected in the reverse, which is these hyper-securitized compounds where you're trying to, you know, algorithmically measure, which may be actually similar to what people are trying to do with language in a different modality, but like where you're trying to account for all the parametric variations or, you know, all the kind of modes through all the automating, basically the production of the space, and that you're trying to think always on the spectrum of potentials and to have them all preset.
So with that, thank you. Thank you.